All right, we're now moving on to item number 9. This is an item that I put on the agenda. You all may recall that Governor Ducey has led the charge on what cities and counties could do throughout the state of Arizona when it came time to this pandemic. He dictated what took place. But Governor Ducey, I believe, got burned after the riots in Scottsdale and the George Floyd thing, and he imposed a statewide curfew. At that time, cities, including ours, and in not only in Bullhead City, but Lake Havasu City, Kingman, and Mojave County, objected. We said we don't have a protest, a violent protest situation going in our community, and we were not going to impose, we were not going to do his imposed curfew requirement. I believe it was then that Governor Ducey realized that perhaps he should allow us a little more leeway in some of the things that we do regarding the pandemic. So he authorized the cities and counties to decide for themselves whether or not they wanted to impose mask requirements. At the time that was done, both Nevada and California required masks of their citizens. At first, we objected. Our numbers were low, and the mayors in Kingman, Lake Havasu, and Bullhead City all agreed that our numbers were low, and we did not want to impose that mask requirement. But then all of a sudden, our numbers started spiking. I had the ability, as the mayor of this town, during a crisis, to order the mask requirement myself. And I chose to do that because our numbers were climbing daily. I did it in consultation with the mayors in the other two communities and the County Board of Supervisors. The mayors in Lake Havasu City and Lake Havasu City also agreed that their numbers were climbing, and in that same week, they too imposed mask requirements on the citizens. Each of our requirements are very similar, but we labored long and hard as to what we would say. And I, along with city staff, said that masks would be required when in a public establishment. That was all on me. And it was done because I have the authority to do it. And to have the city council meet on things of utmost importance in a timely manner when we only meet twice a week, I did it. Now, in the next item we're going to talk about, that will be the closures of the beach, which is something I also did through the authority that I have. But now that we're going to be discussing whether or not the beaches should be closed, I thought now would be a good time to bring back the mask requirement, to make it a council vote, and to also hear from the public. So that's why I brought it back. So on item number 9, we will be discussing approving the face mask covering mandate within the city in response to the increasing number of positive COVID-19 cases. So I'm gonna open it up to the public first because we wanna hear from you. I know there's lots of people who totally disagree with the mask requirement, and I've heard that very loudly before and after the mask requirement was in place. So let's hear from you right now. Royanne, you've been saying all along, and I'm sure we're gonna hear it again.
Yes, thank you, Mayor, council members, and staff. I know we think we have an expert in Dr. Fauci that's telling the nation all of us need to wear masks. All we have to do is wear them for another 3 or 4 weeks and everything will be just fine. But we all have to do it all at one time. So my question is, if masks work, why are we letting people out of jail? Why don't we just give them masks? If masks work, why are we all social distancing? And the gentleman that was up here saying the second you touch a mask, it's contaminated if you're infected. I just don't think it's should be mandatory. I think if people want to do it, if they feel better, and definitely if they are sure that they're infected, and speaking about getting tests, not too many people want a swab ran up their nose. It's not a very pleasant experience. And once you have it done once, you don't want to have it done every week because it's painful. There are other ways to test people, but apparently we're not doing that. And several of the people that I work with have gotten tests, and guess what? One was 4 weeks ago. She still doesn't know how she tested. And another one was about the same period of time, and guess what? They don't know what she tested. They lost her test. I mean, come on, this is all coming out of Warmick. I don't think I'd trust them to do anything. But in the meantime, about masks, that's the topic. I don't think it ought to be mandatory. I think if people want to do it, they should do it. I have medical reasons for not wanting to do it. Makes it hard for me to breathe. But that's my own fault. That's 25 years of smoking that caused that. So I would implore each of you on this council who have a vote to vote masks as a recommendation to the public instead of a mandate. Thank you.
And Toby, I guess I should have allowed you to speak first because you did say that you wanted to address some of these things, so that might educate the public exactly what the mask requirements do require.
I'd be happy, and I can make it very brief, but in the resolution that you adopted and also the one in front of the council, it does provide under section 4 the intent. It says it is the intent of this proclamation to educate and obtain the voluntary compliance of all responsible citizens within the city. That's where other cities across the country have added some other terms and fines and forfeitures if caught without. We do not have that. So not sure if there's businesses out there saying there's a fine for not wearing a mask. That is not the case. Now, that being said, the city does go out and educate. We've hit all kinds of businesses with educational material. You see the posters on the doors. We've handed out courtesy masks to businesses who say they don't have any, and we've educated them saying it is mandatory. We want you to make sure everyone's wearing a mask, with the exceptions. And in the resolution under section 3, there's a number of exceptions that need to be pointed out. A child under 6, a person with medical conditions, a person who is communicating with someone who's hearing impaired, an individual who's obtaining a service involving the nose or face, public safety, police, fire, health are exempt, a person in federal, state, or county buildings, because we're not trying to dictate what happens in those buildings, persons while eating or drinking in a restaurant, business owners, managers, and employees who are in an area of a business that is not open to customers, an individual in a lodging establishment who's inside of the lodging unit, private or public schools in the city as they have their own governing board policies, city hall, city facilities closed to the public. If public access is allowed, employees and visitors must wear a mask. And then individuals engaged in outdoor work or outdoor recreation. So those are the exemptions where people do not have to wear a mask or are exempted from it. And there are no fines, but in essence, it is a mandatory mask requirement.
And I might also add that when the subject first came up, you may recall when we resisted requiring the mask, we issued a proclamation and we strongly encouraged our public to wear masks when outside, and we strongly encouraged our businesses to require masks. That didn't happen. Strongly encouraging somebody did not happen. I didn't see anybody wearing masks, and none of the businesses that we know of said, the mayor said, we don't have to do it, so we're not doing it. They put signs on their door, said masks are strongly encouraged. But when our numbers started to spike, that's when a decision was made, along with others, to require the masks. So let's move on to Harvey.
Thank you very much again, Mr. Brady. You did an interview that I'm sure a lot of people didn't see, and you made a very good point about the masks and the beach, and I hope you don't mind me blending these two together. You was using the numbers of firefighters available, how many firefighters might be infected, crews, how long they might be down, what you have for reserves, and the same for the hospitals and such. Is there any chance that, I don't know if the fire chief is available to answer these questions, to tell us what we do have, how many firefighters and first responders in our area might be affected, and are we running low? I mean, because if we are running low and we don't have very many firefighters and first responders because of sickness and stuff and quarantines, then you're absolutely correct. We need to keep the masks on. We need to keep the beaches closed. And we need to go by what resources we do have available. So if possible, I'd like to know what those numbers are.
No, I meet regularly with the fire chief. And just recently he told me that they are shorthanded because of firefighters who either got it or they all live together.
Right.
And if one of them gets it, then they have to quarantine. So he says that they are operating on a very limited basis. The fire chief told me that they recalled some of the firefighters that were fighting fires elsewhere in the state just so that they would be available for our use. The chief also said that he was asked by a fire department down in the Phoenix area if he could supply any firefighters because their whole fire department was decimated and they didn't have enough to respond to their own community. The chief said, he said, go no further. I can't spare anybody to help you. So those are the types of things that I think are extremely important in protecting our community. If our firefighters can't respond, it's going to be like the Trump commercials. This is 911. We'll get back to you in 15 minutes. I don't think that's the appropriate response we want in our community.
I agree with you 1,000,000%, and I hope everyone here agrees with you also. And I hope everybody in the audience will use that common sense thinking to think that when we need help, we're going to be calling somebody. We need them to be able to come to us. And if that means we got to wear a damn mask, we got to wear a damn mask. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Harvey.
Y'all have a beautiful day.
Good evening. My name is Karen Moscato, and I thank you for allowing me to address you. Leadership demands courage, now more than ever, as we have politicized a common enemy, the coronavirus. We are in a crisis, as the virus is destroying our citizens' health and our economy. To defeat this enemy, we must use a proactive, systematic approach based on facts and measurements to defeat the enemy so that in turn we can open our economy. If we defeat the virus, we save the economy. Societies such as ours have rules and regulations to protect each other. As we learn more about our environment, we put in safeguards to protect its citizens. Some of these are stop signs, seat belts, innocent until proven guilty, right to property, and the list goes on. Wearing a mask is one of those regulations that we have learned protects each other. We know these simple steps control the virus. Wear a mask, wash your hands, testing, contact tracing, isolation. I know we are intelligent enough to read and understand the medical significance of the mask in beating this virus. But for those of us who need a refresher, researchers emphasize there are two main reasons to wear masks. There's some evidence of protection for the wearer, but the stronger evidence is that masks protect others from catching an infection from the person wearing the mask. And infected people can spread the virus just by talking. Specifically with to mask or not to mask, there is a reason doctors and nurses wear one every time they help us at our worst, because they want to reduce their risk of getting sick. This is our reality. You, your best friend, a guy walking down the street can have it and not even know it. It may not affect you, but it could dramatically affect you. It could cause permanent health issues, or even it could cost you or someone you love their life.
Karen, I'm going to ask you to finish it up.
I'm almost done. Thank you, Mayor. My family and I lost our cousin in April to New Orleans, in New Orleans, to COVID-19. He was an EMT helping others when he contracted the virus and died. So, in closing, it's a simple formula. We beat the virus, we save our economy.
Thank you.
And crucial in controlling the virus is wearing a mask.
Thank you, Karen.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Next.
Hi, good evening. My name is Tina Nunez, and I'm just a regular citizen here of the Bullhead City area. And I know there's a lot of different research out there. It depends on where you get the research from, but I do believe that masks are not going to stop the virus from coming against us. I do believe that it's about staying healthy, getting outside, getting vitamin D, taking care of ourselves. I don't see a lot of communication encouraging people to get out and to care for themselves and to do what's necessary to keep everybody healthy. I feel like everyone's just out there wearing what they consider a Band-Aid to try to infect the other person. There's a lot of people in the community that are very healthy, and it's so sad to go out and see everybody masked up. Nobody's looking at anybody. Kids are being shamed. People that aren't wearing masks are being shamed. There is such division because of the masks. So I just ask that you consider all of the evidence to support your decision. And with the beaches, my family and I go to the beach every single day to get out and get some sunshine.
The beaches will be the next item.
That'll be separate? Okay. So just, I would ask you consider all angles, all evidence when you're making this mandate for the community. Thank you.
Ma'am.
I am Ray Rines. I work at the community park at the Chamber of Commerce. And I know the beaches are next, Mayor, but I have to leave after I'm done. I agree with what you've done. I've seen what they did to our beaches over the 4th of July. Okay. The other thing on the mask, I just went from here to Colorado. And everywhere I went, any store, shopping center, gas station, you had to wear a mask. And even driving down the highway, there are signs across the highway, mask required. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Terry Work. I thank you for your time. I'm speaking out on the mask requirement. And to be honest, I wouldn't wear it if my wife didn't tell me to. But my background is, through my work, I would wear a mask. I worked at U.S. Borax, a lot of dust in the processing of that. Air has to be filtered out. We're trained, if we have our mask off, sneeze into your elbow. Turn away. I'm not seeing that. We're also trained to, after wearing a mask for 20 or 30 minutes, take it off. Go outside, get some fresh air instead of rebreathing the bad stuff you're breathing, because masks don't filter everything. I'd like to also mention that it's hard to take it seriously, like people like me, wearing their dust masks that I wear for riding my bike or my Jeep and like that. It's perforated here in my nose. It's hard for me to take it seriously when I go to the market, Safeway, and they're standing there like this with their nose out or on their chin. It's hard for me to take this seriously when I see somebody, when I was in high school, you wore this protective shield, a shop mask, in case something hit you in the eye. If you sneeze with that, you basically sneezed on a windshield and it drips down. That's not protecting yourself and that's not protecting others. If this was really serious, they would be required to have a certain type of mask. It would be required by the state that we're issued these masks. And as far as the testing goes, again, I consider this a joke. I've had family members that have been tested and it came back positive. And then they rebutted it because we questioned it because it was a person at the desk sending it, not a doctor. When asked for that, they said, "Oops, you really had pneumonia."
All right, thank you, sir. Anyone else? In the back, Scotty, sit down. Let's the gentleman in the back got up before you.
Earlier, you had said that Governor Ducey had mandated that we wear masks and
no.
What was it?
The Governor Ducey allowed the cities and counties to decide for themselves whether or not they wanted to impose a mask
requirement. That Governor Ducey had said that it was the riots. That he had mandated that we have a curfew.
Yes.
And you and other cities decided we're not going to follow that. Was that? I guess I don't understand that because everything's kind of black and white to me. If someone of authority told us to do it and we didn't do it, what good is it going to do to do this with the mask and everything if we don't follow it, other people aren't going to follow it? Do you understand what I'm saying
mm-hmm.
on that? He didn't tell us for sure, or what was his authority on telling us to do that, and we just said no.
It was one of the times when mayors throughout the state of Arizona, mostly all in the rural areas, said we are not having riots in our community and there is no need for us to impose curfews on our citizens. So we actually defied the governor.
I definitely agree with that. I didn't think we should have it either. I just don't understand that we didn't, you guys, different mayors didn't go to Governor Ducey and say, hey, this isn't right. We need to do it, not do this, and have him then rescind it or something. Instead, it's like me saying to a police officer, it doesn't work for me, so I'm not going to do it.
All right. Thank you, sir. Greg?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, City Council. In regards to the mask wearing and so forth like this, I'm all for it. 159% for it. Okay, so we're going to talk about a Band-Aid. So what do you reach for when you cut your finger? Oh, let me think, a Band-Aid. It's a precautionary measure. You either get it or you don't. You know what you call the ones that don't? Victims. And they're going to be walking around spreading it to other people. Oh, they're going to be called victims too. The dang mask worked well enough for anybody's purposes. We're not all brain freaking surgeons over here. And you know what? If you can save somebody by doing it, or even using that damn sanitary, do it. It's called a precautionary measure. Kind of like a safety belt, kind of like any other thing that we know is going to keep you out of trouble. If it saves one person, it just saved 100. I don't believe that everybody with an opinion is really worthy within reason. They're not going to tell you anything but how they feel about it. And if they're on the dull end of that conversation, the part that goes, oh, not me, well, then you're going to turn that into the other person. It's not just about us. It's about who we love, who we come in contact with, and people we'll never meet again by touching the podium or any other dang thing. It's transferable here, there, and the other. And until we know more about it, we don't. Thank you.
Thank you. Scotty.
Yeah, Toby, is this the same resolution that we had before? I can still drive and get out of my car and walk up to McDonald's and put my mask on and then enter?
Yes.
Is that the same thing? So nothing's really changing. You're just, you made a proclamation, so they're just approving it.
And we're listening, listening to the public input of our community.
Okay, so you're just kind of making it more official.
Yes.
Okay, so that's cool. I mean, like I told you last time, I went to California in June. You don't get gas, you don't get nothing anywhere. I mean, it's a state law. You don't go into the rest stops. You better have your mask on to go to the bathroom, or they will get you. So I don't know. I can breathe, but not with a mask. But I can make a quick trip into McDonald's in the morning, and I put it on. It's the right thing to do. And it only takes me a minute or two in there. I can handle it that amount of times. So, and it looks like I can go into Safeway again with a mask.
Hi, I've already addressed the council. My name is Joyce Bruget, and I would like to speak in favor of not mandatory, but voluntary, if we feel the need. I feel that, and I, not only me, but many doctors, and I've been following this really closely on the internet, many doctors feel that the mask can be injurious to healthy people because you're breathing moist air and the germs are sticking to the mask. Anything coming in, and virus, it's not going to stop a virus. That is, Fauci already said that right at the beginning, all this, that the mask cannot stop a virus. The only thing a mask will do is contain a sneeze or a cough of a person. It's not going to stop a virus. So, you know, it can be injurious according to OSHA standards. They are inhibiting or prohibiting intake. And there are certain levels that are considered by OSHA as a standard. It is the law. And people have tested, they've tested the intake coming in through the mask, and they are inhibiting oxygen. Okay, so how about the people that have to work all day with this thing over their face? And it's not protecting them, it's actually causing more harm. So if OSHA has a standard about this, maybe we should pay attention to that and consider that there are other people that, even if you don't have a health problem, you could be getting one by continually wearing. And the long term, if you wear one, you're supposed to take it off in a few minutes, whatever it takes, and discard it. Who has big boxes of masks around to, you know, it does not make any sense. If it doesn't stop a virus, then what is the deal? Why are we all being mandated to wear them? So that's about all I can say. There's a lot of information out there, and I suggest everybody look a little deeper. If you feel comfortable, more comfortable wearing a mask, by all means do it. But don't force healthy people. That's all I've got to say.
Thank you
very much for listening.
Billy?
Billy Pershing, does the city, on this contact tracing, does the city accumulate data about the hospital saturation of COVID-19 patients? And does the city also get information through the contact tracing as to what type of establishments, be it fitness centers, bars, restaurants, the beaches, do they get feedback about people that have possibly contacted the virus through those?
Is that your only question, Billy?
That's it.
Toby, do you want to answer that?
Yeah, be happy to. So the contact tracing is all done by Mojave County Public Health, and they don't give us an exact number per person. You know, where did that person pick up COVID-19? Where was it at? Now, we know from when in our meetings with them that they blame, you know, group settings, nursing homes, right? In Bullhead City, we had quite an outbreak in our nursing homes. Parties, birthday parties, graduation parties, funerals, I mean, unfortunately. So they have tied that back to that, but we don't have exact numbers, exact cases. They don't share that with us. They just give us that empirical data that, yes, it happens in big group settings like parties. We did ask about the beaches. They weren't able to tie any back a few weeks ago when we asked that question, or even outside for that matter. Now, that may have since changed. The hospital has given us information about their daily intake, their daily number of patients, their daily, how many people are on vents, how many people are in their ICU. So we do see those numbers, and they change every day. So it's you base decisions, and Mayor Brady based his decisions for those proclamations based on all that information that he was given.
Okay, so you do have some feedback as a foundation for making city decisions as far as...
As much feedback as is able to be shared with us by the hospital legally, by public health legally. I think the County Board of Supervisors gets a lot more information than we do because public health is part of their government agency. But we do get a fair amount of information from public health, as much as they can legally share with us.
Can you give any indication as to what the hospital saturation is with COVID patients? Is it essentially overflowed?
At this point in time, I haven't reviewed it in the last few days, but my understanding from a most recent report that I can recall is that their numbers had gone down. I don't know, Mayor, if you remember the most recent report.
We got the report just this afternoon, and it looked as though the beds available were at about 50% in the COVID unit, in the ICU.
Thank you very much.
But they're also getting new people every day. Just on July 27th, we had 45 new cases. So I don't know how many of them might have shown up to the hospital, but let's just say it's 20 people, which is probably a low average that they're seeing on a daily basis. Many of those people are admitted, so those numbers of available beds go up and down every day. They don't want us to share the information with the general public. It's information that's given to us. HIPAA laws require them to be a little silent on some of those numbers. But it's very important for us to know also, Toby, you might address this, the addresses of the people for law enforcement purposes.
So we do receive from Mojave County Public Health, we do receive the addresses of the individuals who have been reported as COVID positive, so that when the call comes into dispatch from that particular location, whether it be a nursing home or a residential home, that it's COVID positive, so that police and fire know that they must wear PPE when they arrive and that they're protecting themselves. And so that's a little bit of information that we do get. So we also know when those homes come off the list. So when they're recovered, we know that those homes are no longer COVID positive locations.
And initially, when all of this started, we had a hard time getting that information for the protection of our first responders. But now I think they're doing a good job of disseminating that information to us. All right, is there anyone else who would like to address this item? All right, then I will close the call to the public on this item. Do any council members have anything they would like to say?
I have a comment, Mr. Mayor. I'm really tired of wearing these masks, and you know, it's irritating to my skin, my throat, my nose, everything's dry. But I did do some research, and I did reach out to a couple of local physicians, one of them who did travel to New York to help up there when their cases were really, really high. And I asked him, do these masks really make a difference? And his answer was absolutely, they do make a difference. So, you know, I'm really, really torn. Again, I wear it every day at work. If I go into a store, if I go to a restaurant, if I'm outside being active, of course I don't wear it. But there is research out there that does show that it does make a difference. That's just my comment.
Anyone else?
Mr. Mayor, I think Ms. Moscano did a great job talking about this, but I spoke to a couple of physicians down at the University of Arizona, and the one thing that they told me is this isn't going to be 100% effective, but it's 85% effective is what they found from their studies. That's a pretty good percentage of safety. Like I said, nothing is probably going to be 100% unless you're in a bubble. But 85%, I think, goes a long way in helping stop the spread of this here in our community. And I think we need to take that into consideration. And I told people before, I was very supportive of the mayor's proclamation to put this in place initially, and I'm still supportive of it.
Sheila.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I have just a couple comments. First, I want to thank the residents that have emailed us. I got several, I don't know, maybe 10, 11 emails regarding this particular item on the agenda, and they were pretty much split. It was very close. There's two things that really bothered me about the whole situation. I am very anti-mask, but that I'll talk about that in a minute. You go to the grocery store and they put up a shield in front of the person that's checking you out, but that person is touching every single thing that's going in your bag that's going home. It bothers me. You go in a grocery store and you pick up something on the shelf, you might be sick. You might not have covered up your face. You might have, and now your germs are on that can of soup that somebody else is gonna come and buy. There's so much going on that it's over my head. With all that being said, I still come down to, I would rather err by saying that I support wearing a mask than to err by saying we don't need masks and then feel really bad when somebody dies because of the motion that I approved or disapproved of. So I am gonna vote for the masks, even though I hate them and I don't like the whole situation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Steve? Mr. Mayor? I have conflicts about this too. I personally didn't wear a mask until they were mandatory. I like social distancing. I like social distancing even when there isn't nothing going on. This here, I don't think it's a big deal. I'm a person that's at risk. I don't think it's a big deal to put a mask on for 30 minutes when you're in the store. However, I feel for the employees that are working in there for 8 hours with that mask on. I wear a mask myself 8 hours a day, 40 hours a week, and I can't take it off for my breaks. I wear the thing the whole time. And it becomes saturated later on in the day, and I actually believe you're actually spraying more out from the mask from breathing once it gets wet. Now, we talk about stats and science. Most of the reports that I've seen that favor the mask. I've always seen the word, you read the fine print, it says it may help, may decrease. I've never seen something where it said it will, always may. Now, if you look at, on July 1st is when we implemented our mandatory mask, and we had 200 cases at the time. July 12th, 190. July 26th, 178. Did the mask help? Did it not help? I know personally people that have gotten COVID wearing the mask at their place of employment. Numerous people at their place of employment. Numerous people at rest homes where I don't think they're going out in the public. And I just don't, there has to be a point where there comes personal responsibility, yep, where people take care of themselves. I'm tired of hearing people on both sides of the issue. If you're not wearing the mask, you don't care about anybody but yourself. If you are wearing the mask, you're a sheep. I believe in both of those sides. It's your own personal responsibility. Like I said, when I go into a place, I make sure I stay 6 feet away. And I'm not afraid to tell somebody, hey buddy, you mind getting away a little bit? I'd like my personal space here, as opposed to wearing the mask. Another thing here, if you read section 4 up here of this proclamation, it says, is the intent of this proclamation to educate and obtain the voluntary compliance of all responsible citizens within the city? This is still basically voluntary. There's no way to enforce this on here. We're not enforcing it, but I can tell you these employees put up with a lot of shit. They're getting yelled at. I myself have been threatened to have my face spit in, threatened to get my ass kicked in the parking lot because they don't want to wear their mask. And we're not enforcing it, and we're putting it out there. We're just putting all these employees and all our businesses out here through hell. So I just say, I think we need to step up. We don't need the government to be your nanny. I think it's time for personal responsibility, and I'm going to be voting no. Thank you.
Steve, Council Member D'Amico, you said exactly what I'm thinking. You know, where is the personal responsibility for your own health and safety? Seriously. This is, we are responsible. That's part of what's wrong with this country right now. Everybody's crying, somebody gotta take care of yourself. Take care of your own family. We know the disease is out there. We know people get sick. If you're a healthy, you can't keep healthy people covered up and this is not mentally healthy for healthy people. I believe that. So I am voting no, but I wanna make this very clear. I love shopping at Smart and Final. I love it. Nobody puts a gun to my head to go there, but I will tell you, every time I put this on and I go in there, do you know why I put this mask on my face? It's called respect. Respect for the business, respect for the other customers. That's what you do, it's respect. When you go to somebody's house, and I hate these people, but they're, oh, take off the shoes, get the shoes off. Well, the floor is made for walking on. But you know what? I take off my shoes. Why? Respect. And that's what we're missing here. But I forcing people to have this thing on their face is inappropriate, I believe. Thank you.
I just wanted to add a little bit. Even if we were to vote no for this, I still will be wearing my mask into the stores. Absolutely. I won't be told to mandatorily. It will be my decision to wear it into the store. If you see a store where it says mandatory mask and you don't want to wear one, don't go in there. If you see a store that says you don't have to wear a mask and you're not comfortable, don't go in there. I believe the businesses have the right to run their businesses. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to add to my comment earlier as well, because Hilde Angus just texted me and called me out. But anyway, there is a lot of research out there, and we know that, and it's on both sides. So there's research that says it protects us. There's research that says that it doesn't do any good for us. But I wear it every day. When I go outside to work out, I don't wear it. And I consider myself a pretty healthy person. However, it is respect and responsibility. I will continue to wear my mask, but I think we as individuals should have that choice, not the governor. It's just something that we should take responsibility for. I'm not going to vote for, I'm going to vote no on this, but I'm going to wear my mask where I feel it's necessary. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor.
Unfortunately, I disagree with some of you, and I will be voting yes, because I think we're seeing the downturn, and I think it's helping. It may not be the answer to everything, but I think for another 30, 45 days, let's keep the masks on.
And then I guess I'm last, and as my discussion with Harvey prior, I guess I'm looking at it in a different manner. It's not the personal responsibility, and it's like if you're, I'm not a scientist, I'm not a doctor, I'm not a health professional. I acknowledge that there's controversy surrounding this pandemic, and the statistics that are being thrown around are questionable to the point of millions worldwide are calling it a hoax. I've said all along that the only statistics that I truly follow deal with how prepared our hospitals and first responders are to treat you should you become seriously ill with this very deadly virus. And to those of you who say it's only the old who are dying and they would have died anyway if it were the flu, I say shame on you. I don't buy that at all. I point just recently to Kathy Hewart, a retired 61-year-old retired nurse who answered the call and returned to offer her services at Wormsea. Kathy died on July 12th from COVID-19. Kathy had no major underlying health issues. I'll also point out Lake Havasu Regional Medical Center Dr. Nick Rizos, who died from COVID-19 on July 31st. Dr. Rizos practiced medicine in Lake Havasu City for over 30 years when he contracted the disease. Dr. Rizos reported that he was feeling a bit short of breath and he expected to fully recover, but he unexpectedly lost consciousness and he passed away. And I have a personal friend that I know at least four of us on this dais know, roughly my age and a diabetic. His only health condition, he's diabetic. He is currently hospitalized in Glendale, Arizona, and has been on a ventilator for over 3 weeks, clinging to life. Say what you will, I, for one, do not believe this virus is an ordinary flu. I believe it's life-threatening, and we have over 40 states that have some sort of mask requirement imposed. And how prepared are we? Let me point out a July 23rd Lake Havasu Herald news story titled, Havasu Hospital seeks staffing help from county. According to the spokesperson from that hospital, they requested additional nursing support due to the relatively high volume of patients they were seeing that month. So now we're faced with real life examples of local healthcare workers dying, otherwise healthy friends on ventilators, hospitals running short of nursing staff, and dozens of senior citizens who have told me they won't venture out of their home except for essentials. I will be voting to continue the mask requirement through September 16th as presented, and I urge all of you to do the same.
Mayor Brady. Our city attorney wanted me to clarify one thing. In our conversations, just minimizing the education point, you can be cited under state law for not wearing a mask. We've chosen to educate first, and that's all we've intended to do. But these are class one misdemeanors, as per our city attorney, the way the resolutions are written. To date, the only situation I'm aware of, though, is an individual being cited for trespass and aggravated assault for not wearing a mask. So the issue escalated when the person was told out of business to not wear. But in talking with Chief Williamson, rather than citing them under a state law for a class one misdemeanor, we would, if the business asked them to leave, we would ask them to leave as well. And if they wouldn't, it would be more of a trespass than a not wearing of a mask. So I don't want there to be the opinion of anybody listening that there's no repercussions for not wearing a mask. If a business tells you to leave, you must leave. And there are repercussions if enforcement were meant by council to do that. Our resolution isn't written that way, however. And again, we're out there every day educating and asking businesses to enforce the provisions. And almost every business in this community is enforcing the provisions.
All right, thank you.
Mr. Mayor, I'd just like to say that I agree with my colleagues on council that, you know, people need to take responsibility for their own actions. However, unfortunately, the way this disease works is you may not know you have it, and you could be wandering around and talking to people, and if you didn't have that mask to help protect them, you could be infecting somebody without even knowing it. There are people that have had COVID that really didn't even know it. So, because their symptoms have been so mild. So this is not just a protection for you, but it's a protection for others. And you need to keep that in mind as well.
All right.
Mr. Mayor, I have one more question, I'm sorry. So this is gonna be extended to September 16th?
Yes.
And at that time, it will be reevaluated and possibly...
And I'm gonna bring it back to council because we have a meeting on the 15th and we will vote again and the weight will be lifted off of my shoulders for making that decision by myself.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
All right, it appears as though we have some controversy, some dissension amongst the council. So how about if we do a roll call vote, Madam Clerk? Oh, we need a motion. Do we have a motion on the floor?
Mr. Mayor, I move to approve 9 as presented.
Second.
We have a first and a second to approve the wearing of masks as presented. All in favor of the motion, well, no, let's do the roll call vote.
Okay. Councilmember Clark, your vote?
Yes.
Councilmember Wegman, your vote?
No.
Councilmember Ring, your vote?
No.
Vice Mayor D'Amico, your vote?
No.
Councilmember Schutz, your vote?
Yes.
Councilmember Bruck?
Yes.
Mayor Brady?
Yes.
Right. 4 in favor and 3 opposed. Motion carries.
All right, let's move.